I think maybe we can pivot to maybe the antihistamines. I know that, famotidine was associated with reduced mortality in acute COVID-19. Super easy medicine to get. You could get into a local drugstore and pick that up. And it is a treatment for mast cell activation. And then, of course, we've got all our other kind of antihistamines that we can try. I think it can become confusing for patients because there's so many different types out there. But yeah, I think maybe we can do a little bit of a dive into that.
Yeah, so H2 blockers, the one that was studied was famotidine, so Pepcid. And basically, they noticed that people who were on Pepcid had reduced mortality from acute COVID. And so this is, they don't know exactly the mechanism for that. It's possible maybe it's been elucidated since, but Pepcid actually has quite a few different things that it does. So it lowers stomach acid, but it also it blocks histamine type 2 receptors. That's actually how it lowers stomach acid. It is an H2 blocking antihistamine. And there may be other things that it's doing. There may be some immune modulatory effects and stuff too. So this one is good for mortality reduction. And also, we've seen a fair amount of mast cell symptoms showing up in patients with long COVID. And so anything that's going to help keep your mast cells a little bit more stabilized and calmed down, kind of help block some of the effect of that, I think would have benefits. And that may actually be part of the reason that famotidine is helping, perhaps.
Yeah, no, exactly.
There are other H2 blockers. But I think it was like Zantac was taken off the market due to a manufacturing issue that they thought had some chemical that caused cancer. But I believe there's now a Zantac on the market that just contains famotidine. It's basically Pepcid. And then there's Tagamet, which is cimetidine, but Tagamet has a lot more drug interactions than Pepcid does, and so generally Pepcid's the safer one. And Pepcid was the one that was kind of the famotidine specifically was the one that was kind of in the studies because they use it frequently in the hospital. And then H1 blockers, so another type of antihistamine, but the standard ones, more ones you're familiar with as an antihistamine. So like your Allegra, Claritin, Zyrtec, Zizol, those are all the trade names for them. But basically, these are the ones that you take if you've got allergies and you're sniffling and the pollen's high outside.
I know you use this religiously. You have done a very good job at not getting COVID. I will use it. Kind of when I go out and spray my nose. But there are several things, and again, a little bit more of a deep dive. You can find that YouTube. But maybe just like a few one-liners on that would be really helpful.
Yeah, so usually, COVID typically infects you through your nose and through your mouth. And most of the viral load initially is there. And so anything you can do to reduce viral load is going to help reduce like mortality risk, severity of your acute infection. But also one of the risk factors for long COVID development was how high your viral load was kind of like during the acute infection. So anything you can do to reduce viral load is going to be helpful. And so basically, it can be any kind of nasal rinse, even just saline, high volume neti pot saline. If you do that twice a day and do a real good rinse, that actually improved mortality rates in acute COVID. But there are some things that have some kind of antiviral components to the spray that have also been studied, and they've been shown to have even more of a like risk reduction. And we went through all of these in detail in our previous talk that's more about like COVID prevention. But the one that I use because it's cheap and relatively available is colloidal silver. There was a placebo-controlled study that was done at a hospital in Mexico, and they were actually looking at risk reduction of people who were all exposed to COVID patients. They were taking care of them in hospitals, and they found a pretty very large reduction in COVID infection in the people who were using colloidal silver versus the people who were using just saline as the control. Just like you'd have an emergency earthquake kit or tornado kit or whatnot, depending on where you live, have an emergency COVID kit. Get this stuff ahead of time. Have a plan. Ask the questions of your doctor, your pediatrician, whatnot, ahead of time so that you're not scrambling to figure this out when you're acutely sick and feel really bad. And so, really, the thing is, if you're mostly young and healthy, yes, you can still die from COVID, but your bigger risk at that point is long COVID. And don't take that risk lightly. we treat long COVID patients, yeah. and it is amazing. It's taken like, I mean, marathon runners, hardcore athletes, people who were not winded running like 10 miles are now winded walking up one flight of stairs. And this was within like 3 to 4 weeks of having this virus. So it's not like they were just deconditioned. You don't drop from a 10-mile yeah. runner to, I can't walk up a flight of stairs in 1 to 2 months. It takes a lot longer than that to decondition. And they've done studies that show that it's not deconditioning. So really, it's roughly on average 10% of people. So 1 in 10 will get long COVID after a COVID infection. And it's not mm-hmm. like, you know, and we don't know like repeated infections. Does your risk go up? If you've had COVID now your fifth time, we don't know. Vaccination does seem to reduce your risk of long COVID, but it reduces it a fairly minimal amount, something like maybe about 15%. It seems like it does stack though. So the more vaccines you have, it keeps kind of adding on to the risk reduction, but it's a fairly like minor risk reduction. So compared to like metformin taken during acute COVID. So just don't underestimate long COVID. If you can help reduce it, even just adding metformin, if you can't even get Paxlovid or Tolovid, even just metformin, just mm-hmm. reducing that risk of long COVID, because let me tell you, you do not want that disease. You just don't.
Yep. I gotcha. Well, thanks so much for chatting, and I enjoyed it. And hopefully we can help a few folks avoid getting long COVID and doing okay with their acute COVID. And yeah, have a good rest of the day.
All right. Thanks, everybody. Bye. Bye.